Good morning. I am so glad to get to be here today. I'm going to get a table as soon as possible. And this wonderful young man is going to be bringing it to me. Look at him. Everyone clap it up for him. He's doing his best. How are y'all doing this morning? Ooh, okay. That was really weak. And I haven't been up here before. I'm kind of nervous, so I need you guys to be... Thank you. I'm going to need you guys to be a little bit more energetic, and I need some encouragement, all right? So, all right, good. All right, let's practice a little bit more. Everyone say, that's good. Everyone say, mm-hmm. All right, and everyone say, preach it, white boy. All right, thank you very much. I feel encouraged. First off, I want to say thank you to Jeff and to John for letting me share the platform today. I'm so excited to share a little bit about what God has kind of put on my heart for this year. For those of you who don't know me super well, my name is Conley, and I'm the student pastor here at Crystal Lake. Woo-woo, students! And it's such an honor to get to be here. But there are a couple of things that you guys need to know about me before I start. Number one, I'm from Dallas, Texas, so you may hear some y'alls throughout my time up here. Second thing, I love to lift weights. And then the most important thing you need to know about me is that I'm married to the most amazing wife in the world, Kelsey Jean. Kelsey, can you stand up? Let everyone. Yep, she's not going to stand up. She's a little nervous, but she's amazing. We've been married for 7 months, and it's been the best 7 months of my life so far. So I love you, babe. Okay, today is January 2nd, 2022. Isn't that crazy? I feel like it was just 2020, and 2021 just like flew by. But a new year has come, and it feels like I just started the last one. But most of us are probably planning new things that we're going to be doing. A lot of us are probably like, man, I found this new diet plan. I can lose 30 pounds in 5 days, okay? We're going all out. We're going to do it. Some of us have those crazy plans. But I think too often that we try to jump into things too quickly, too fast. Last year when I got engaged, I decided, you know, that's when I really had to get into working out, you know, because like, the honeymoon was coming up, and so I started getting into working out, and I was like really just pushing the numbers. I was like, I'm gonna bench and squat like as much as possible, and after a while, like a few months of lifting, I realized that I was having like shoulder pain and knee pain, and I, you know, was like, what's going on? I just started, and it turns out, I did some research, and my form was trash, and so my form was bad. And then I also wasn't warming up beforehand. Who knew? You had to warm up, you know, before you go do exercise. But after I fixed those things, I was able to get, like, remove that pain and be able to do the exercises correctly. But if you're like me, then you've done the same thing with your relationship with God. You've rushed past the foundations of your faith, seeking after the deeper things of God. And maybe it could be you've sought answers to, like, these theological questions that, while interesting, don't necessarily hold a ton of practical importance. Thinking that maybe we've graduated like from the elementary stuff that brought us into a relationship with Jesus, when in reality we never graduate from that. So that's why this year, 2022, I'm advocating for us to focus on the foundations of our faith. If we can hone in on this one thing, I'm convinced that our lives, this church, and this city will be impacted in a significant way for the kingdom of God. So, if you're taking notes today, the title of this sermon is Back to the Basics. Back to the Basics. So what are the basics of our faith? Well, I think a similar question was posed to Jesus in Mark 12, verses 28 to 31. So if you all have your Bibles, please turn there with me, Mark 12. If you don't have a physical Bible, please take out your phone, and don't pretend to just read in text, okay? Get your Bible out on the app. You can do this. But while y'all are turning there, I'm going to give you some background for this verse. Immediately preceding this passage, we have Jesus in the temple teaching, and these religious leaders come up to him and are asking him different questions. So one group, the Pharisees, they come up to Jesus. They're asking him about taxes and how we should interact with the government. And then these other people, the Sadducees, they come up, they ask Jesus about marriage and the resurrection. These are really interesting and important questions, but they're not the ones we're going to be focusing on today. Maybe next time, if I do good enough and they invite me back to preach, who knows? Okay, so Mark 12:28. I'm going to read that right now. All right. And one of the scribes came up and heard them disputing with one another, and seeing that he answered them well, asked him, which commandment is the most important of all? So one of the scribes, this guy, he's a scribe, so he like writes for a living, he's literate. He comes up and hears this commotion, hears that Jesus is kind of stumped all these religious leaders, and he decides to ask his own question. And Jesus' answer is perfect, okay? He quotes from Deuteronomy 6, and it would have widely been accepted as like the correct answer. All these Jews would say, oh yeah, makes sense that you chose that. And his response is something called the Shema. So the Shema is a prayer that Jewish people for thousands of years have sung every morning and evening as a way of expressing their devotion to God. This morning, we are gonna sing it together. Cool. So you guys thought you were coming to church, but actually you're coming to synagogue. So we're gonna put it up on the screen. So right here, this is like the transliterated version. So there's the Hebrew, and then there's like our English translations would say, you know, Hear, O Israel, right? This is like if you took the Hebrew letters and chose the English like versions of them, right? So here we go. I'm gonna read it first, and then we're all gonna read it together. Cool? And also traditionally, they would read it, they would sing it aloud with their hands covering their eyes. So I'm gonna do that. Don't feel like you have to do it because you're gonna be reading it. So here we go. I'll go first and then you go. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Right, okay, thank you. The encouragement, guys, the encouragement. Okay, so you gotta remember it's a ch, okay? Echad, okay? You gotta get the ch or it doesn't count and we'll do it again. So here we go. 3, 2, 1. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Wow, good job. Well done. Give it up for yourselves. Click next page. So this is pretty cool, right? We're reading it aloud together in its original language, and it's really different, right? It's kind of cool. But now that we've read this first part of Jesus' answer of the Shema, what does it mean? Like, what do we do with it? Well, thank you for asking. This is my first point. We must love and obey. We must love and obey. So let's look at verses 29 and 30. Mark 12:29-30. Jesus answered, "The most important is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength." So the people that Jesus is talking to, they know the Shema. They know it inside and out. They've said it, they've sung it aloud twice a day for their entire lives. So they know what Shema means. It's a cool word, Shema. And I think that parents and spouses, we need to take this word and put it in our back pocket. Because it means to hear or to listen, as you can see it's translated, but it also means obey. So when it says, Israel, listen up. It isn't a passive thing. God wants them to respond and do something, okay? Love, in the same way that Shema means hear and obey, love is also an action word. It's not passive. Last week we got to hear from Pastor JT, and he gave an awesome definition of love, so I'm just going to read that again here. Love is joyful sacrifice for the good of another person, sometimes accomplished by emotion, always accompanied by action. Okay, I'm going to read this one more time. Love is joyful sacrifice for the good of another person, sometimes accomplished by emotion, always accompanied by action. I'll tell you what, I've been learning a lot about what love really is since I've been married these last few months. And there's been a big learning curve. I think one specific thing that I've learned since I've been married is just how selfish I am. I don't know if anyone can like relate to that if you're getting married. But I feel like you go your whole life pretty confident. You're like, yeah, like, you know, I'm a pretty good person. You know, I care about others. And then like you get married and your shortcomings are exposed, like in the best way possible. But it's true, like one thing in particular I learned that I do is that I pretend to listen. like Kelsey will be doing something super helpful for us, like cleaning around the house or like finding the cure for cancer or something. Like she's amazing, she's working, she's doing awesome stuff. And then I'm sitting on the couch on my phone on Facebook Marketplace looking at gym equipment and, you know, equally important things. And not really, but she comes over and she briefly asks me like, can you do this one thing, like just a small thing, you know, while I'm doing all this amazing stuff? Like, can you just take out the trash for me? And I'm like, babe, yeah, of course. Like, I love you. And then I sit there and I don't do it. and then she comes back 30 minutes later and I'm caught red-handed and I haven't done anything. That's not cool. I do that way too often, but I'm working on it. But when I do that, I hear Kelsey, but I don't Shema Kelsey. And I love her, but I'm not showing that I love her. So love and listening, obedience, doing things, they're all actions. They're interconnected. You can't love someone without action. And to truly hear someone and listen to them, we should do something about the things we're hearing. So sometimes like when we hear that commandment to hear and to love God with everything we are, we take it as a passive thing. We're like, all right, yeah, for sure. I listen to sermons. I listen to K-Love. Like, you know, and I love God. What a great guy. I think about him, I get all warm and fuzzy inside. What a good pal, you know? Love that God guy. But no, like how has it changed you? How has hearing from God changed your life? Are you more generous? Are you serving your spouse as you should be? Are you surrendering your life more and more to the Lord every single day? One way Kelsey and I are trying to surrender our lives even more is through our finances. This is something that for me, I've realized how like, stingy I can be. Like when we give our tithe, right now we have it so it's automatically tithe, but then I'll like look at my phone, I'll get the notification, I'm like, dang. Like, we could have gone to, like, Texas Day Brazil with that or something. I think about the things that we could have done instead because I'm like, this is mine, I earned it. But what we're trying to do now, and we haven't started yet, this is like a New Year's resolution, but we want to start tithing manually. So instead of it just coming out automatically, we're going to sit down together. We're going to, like, get the correct heart posture and say, you know what, God, this is yours. And just like everything else, this is just something that you've given me for a short time. So it's no problem for me to give this back to you. Like that's just one way that we're stumbling along to surrender more and more of our lives to God. So godly love and listening require action. We can't be on the sidelines. So maybe you're sitting in your seat and you're thinking, okay, I see that God is calling me to listen and love him with my whole heart, but why should I? Like honestly, all of us have stuff that we could focus our entire being on, like our families or our jobs, why, or even like our model train collection. Like why should we not put our time and energy into those things? And why does God deserve all this? Well, dear listener, once again, thank you for asking those questions. Here's my second point, which is we must love and obey the Lord. We must love and obey the Lord. Let's look at verse 30 again. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. So we must love and obey the Lord. I'm going to spend some time now looking at God as both Father and God as Son. I don't have time today to spend on the Holy Spirit, even though my Pentecostal background is like cringing. Just so you know, I didn't forget the Holy Spirit. It's a triune God, but I'm just going to be focusing on the Father and the Son. Cool. So Father God. This is what many of us would think of as like the Old Testament God, capital G God. He's transcendent. He's above it all. And we know he's worthy to be served with all of our being because in Genesis 1, we see that he brings order out of chaos. He makes the entire universe with a few words. And we couldn't even finish our Christmas puzzle. So this is Adonai Eloheinu, the Lord our God. He brought the Israelites out of Egypt through the Sea of Reeds on dry ground. He's the God of miracles. He's above it all. He's holy. He's the Father of creation. And he said something and we should listen to it. Speaking of fathers, my dad is amazing. I love him very much. He looked after me and my siblings really well. He clothed us, gave us all the food we needed, probably more than we needed, and he went to all of our sports games. Sorry, my beard, I think, is getting in the mic. But I was also kind of scared of him. Like, whenever we were in trouble, say we're hanging out in the living room, he'd come into the living room and be like, Conley, can I talk to you in my office for a second? And so we'd have to follow him back to the office. And that hallway from the living room to the office was probably like the most prayed in space in the whole world. But let me tell you, I had this like healthy, I think, respect and fear for my father, and I still do. But I think a lot of times we don't have that same respect for our Heavenly Father. The one, you know, my earthly father, he's the one that like created me, but also my Heavenly Father's the one who knit me together in my mother's womb. That's worthy of my devotion. So that's God the Father, right? Another cool thing about this passage is that Jesus is the one who's speaking here. So God the Son is speaking about God the Father. And Jesus is great because he's like us. He was born in humble circumstances. He lived a typical life. He had friends. He experienced hunger and pain. And he knows what being human is like. He gave up his perfect life so that we could be in relationship with his Father. He took the wrath and pain for all of us. Y'all ever had a friend who took a bullet for you? Probably not, you know, physically. If you had a friend that did that for you, please tell me the story afterwards. But probably for most of us, it's metaphorical, right? When I think about that, I have had a lot of great friends over the years. But one in particular who comes to mind is my buddy from seventh grade, and his name is Peter Lorish. So seventh grade, we're in science class together, and I was a goody two-shoes, by the way. But this one time, we had a substitute that we just did not like whatsoever. She was really loud, and she was mean to us, I guess. And so we decided, I was like, Peter, hey, bro, I dare you to put some fish food in her water bottle. And so we're like, dude, we're gonna get her. And so I dare him, he gets the fish food, he rocks up, sneaks up, puts some in her water, he comes back, and we're like giggling, you know, at our table. And then we're thinking like, bro, she's gonna get it. We're gonna get her. And then, like, not soon after, we look up and the principal has come into our classroom and is taking Peter away. And so apparently we didn't notice it, but one of the girls in our class had like told on us. Judas, right? Trickster. She had told on us. And so as soon as Peter's taken away, I break out in like a cold sweat, you know? Like, I didn't learn a single thing for the rest of the day. I was just watching the door. And I was waiting for my time, waiting for my judgment, because I was the mastermind, you know? And all this time went on, class after class, and I was getting more and more confused. Like, why wasn't I in chains? Why haven't they hauled me away yet? And at the end of the day, I saw Peter, and I was like, bro, what happened? Like, why didn't they take me? He said, dude, they kept asking me, who was the person that dared you? And he's like, I wouldn't give you up. So he didn't give me up, and they added extra time onto his suspension, because he was such a bro for me. And so I was floored, right? He bore my judgment for me. And y'all, Jesus did the same thing, but turn it up to 11. He loved us so much that he was beaten and died for us. What a friend, right? What love. And that's the God we serve. He both made us and died for us. He's worthy of our devotion and so much more. The final question I've heard is like, why does God want us to serve him in the first place? Is he kind of narcissistic? He just wants people to look at him and do what he says so he feels good? No. He's given us instructions as a means to differentiate Christians from non-Christians, to draw them to him. So this is my final point here. We should love and obey the Lord to witness to the lost. We should love and obey the Lord to witness to the lost. So let's look at verse 31. The second is this: You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. So the second most important thing after loving and serving God is loving our neighbor. It's important to God that we love those we interact with as we love ourselves. I don't know about y'all, but nobody looks after me the way I look after me. Like, I make sure I got 3 square meals a day. I make sure I'm in bed by like 10. And, you know, I take care of myself, right? I'm like, oh, gotta get a mental health day. I'm gonna go, you know, get a haircut and whatever. But I make sure myself, if I'm good, maybe I'll even treat myself to some ice cream, you know? I love myself well. I'm like the best one at it. And we're all pretty good at loving ourselves. It's kind of human nature. We're naturally inclined to look after ourselves. And we all know this when we meet kids. If you've had kids or you've spent any time with them, you'll know some of their first words are, mine, no. And they're like so selfish, you know? These kids just don't care about other people's. They'll push other kids to get their toys, and they're just like tyrants. And we look at them, we're like, man, what's up with you? You know, who hurt you? And the thing is, we think that we have become less selfish, but honestly, we've probably just gotten a lot better at hiding it. So the thing to me about loving your neighbor as yourself that is so compelling is that it's just otherworldly. Like, it's unnatural. Loving others when you stand nothing to gain is so far removed from like our base human instincts of just looking after ourselves, taking care of our tribe of people that we're around, and then like fearing others, fearing people who are different than us. But instead, God calls us to treat others with the same love and care we set aside for ourselves. So what might this look like for you? Because we all know that we should be loving others as ourselves, but we don't necessarily know how. So here's one tool that will help you love others as yourself. So you can get a chart like this one and start tracking your time throughout the day, throughout the week. I'm gonna take a quick sidebar and shout out to our DLD class. This is something that you can do with our lovely Brian Bradshaw. This is something that you wanna look into, okay? So basically, you get to go, it's Sundays before church, and you get to be built up and become a better disciple maker, okay? So this is one thing we do in that class. If you want more information about that, please talk to Brian. It's awesome, okay? So this is one thing we do, right? And this is our weekly hourly planner. So you go in throughout your day and you'll be like, okay, at 7 a.m., you know, I spent time on Instagram because I woke up and I picked up my phone and I was on Instagram. And then at 8 o'clock, I had some breakfast and I watched the news. And then at 9 o'clock, I drove to work. And then you'll go throughout your whole day and you'll realize, man, I spent a lot of time just doing things that I want to do. I spent a lot of time working on myself. So what can we do here is we can find margin where we can take time out of our day to specifically love on others. You can find some margin. And this could be where you could love, you know, your family, people at your work, at the gym, wherever you're going, you can have opportunities to love people around you. You could start small. It could be serving at the Hope Center. You could ask the waitress how her day is going, you know, and then you could pray for her at the end of your time there. You could create relationships with your actual neighbors and invite them over and share the gospel with them and invite them to church. God wants us to take our eyes off of ourselves and look around at the people near us who don't know him and love them by serving them and sharing the good news of Jesus the Messiah. So here's my final thing, okay? Let's look at verse 32. And we'll see the scribe's response. So the scribe had the question, Jesus answered, and now here's the scribe again. He goes, you are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one, and there is no other besides him. And to love him with all the heart and with all the understanding and with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself is much more than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. And when Jesus saw that he answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." And after that, no one dared to ask him any more questions. So we see the scribe's response, right? He recognizes the wisdom in God's words, or in Jesus' words. He says, yeah. He adopts the fact that if I can love God with all I am, and I can love my neighbor as myself, then I'm actually gonna be closer to the kingdom of God. So this year, if we wanna get closer to the kingdom of God, if we wanna make it more like heaven here on earth, let's adopt this idea. Let's go back to the basics and give it all to God. As I close, let me add one more caveat to what I've said. I've just spoke for 30 minutes telling you how we've all messed up and what we should do now instead. And I don't want you to walk out of here feeling burdened and feeling like I've given you a laundry list of things that you need to do. Because the beautiful thing about Christianity is that we know we're not enough. We're gonna fail, maybe some of us even right after the service. But our perfect obedience isn't what makes us right with God. Jesus is the one who does that. So when you mess up, pray and invite Jesus to help you take yourself off the throne and put him there instead. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for this day. Thank you that your word can be summed up in two words and two sentences of loving you and loving our neighbor, God. I pray that you'd help us to do that. Lord, I pray that we'd find practical ways today, Lord, as we go to lunch, help us to love on the people who are serving us. Help us to love our families better. Help us to love you better. God, you're all we want and need. We pray, Lord, that you'd help us to put you on the throne of our lives. We love you and praise you. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen.